The Legacy, KCAA 1050 AM and Express 106.5 FM.
KCAA Radio 1050 AM 106.5 FM. We are an NBC affiliate. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Eric J. Chambers, and welcome once again to The Cut Chronicles, where we chronicle urban life. For those of you joining us live and in living color at kcaaradio.com, well, you can click the play button right next to my picture, and you can see us live right here in our studios here in Loma Linda, California. You know, prostate cancer, it is a silent killer that can sneak up on you if you don't keep an eye on it. Well, aside from skin cancer, it is the most common form of cancer affecting men. And according to the American Society of Clinical Oncology's cancer.net, this year alone, an estimated 288,300 men in the United States will be diagnosed with it. And about 60% of those diagnosed will be men over 65 years old. And the majority of those afflicted with this disease happens to be black men. And sadly, they are among the most likely to die from prostate cancer. But joining us tonight to shed light on this illness and how you or a loved one can beat the odds are people who know the sickness all too well. We've got John T. McCall. He's the CEO of DeVille Family and Youth Services of Pasadena. He's a prostate cancer survivor. And also joining us from the City of Hope Hospital is Dr. Gracia Hernandez. She's a postdoctoral fellow. And we're also going to be getting a call from Dr. Kimlin Tam Ashing, also from the City of Hope, and also James Morrison. So we've got an action-packed event here tonight on radio. And also later on in the program, we're going to be taking some phone calls. So if you'd like to call us up, our phone number here in the studio is 909-792-5222. That's 909-792-5222. We're going to be taking some of the calls in the second half hour of the program. But in the meantime, what we're going to do is kickstart the program talking to Dr. Gracia Hernandez. Dr. Hernandez, first of all, welcome to the program.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. First time.
That's right. You're a first-time radio person here. Okay, wonderful. Well, we are excited that this is your maiden voyage on the radio.
Awesome. Thank you.
Okay, tell us a little bit about yourself, your affiliation with this disease called prostate cancer.
So first of all, thank you for having me. This is a great opportunity to promote what we do at City of Hope. The program that I belong to is a postdoctoral training fellowship. So basically what we do, we develop programs that deliver care to specific type of cancers. In my case, I specialize in prostate cancer health disparity, which it's something that we need to tackle, not only at the minority diversity level, but also as a nation. It's an issue that we are trying to come up with solutions. At the clinic and at City Hope, it's a place where we see the action, right? Right in front of our eyes. So one thing, and one of the goals of my research project is to identify modulators or proteins that are important for the development, early development of aggressive disease, especially in patients that come from a minority populations, including African Americans and people from African American ancestry as well.
Okay, well, thank you for that introduction of yourself. And John T. McCall, again, the CEO of DeVille Family and Youth Services. Tell us your affiliation with this. Of course, you are a living survivor of this insidious disease.
Yes, I am part of the iCare consortium with the City of Hope, and I am a prostate cancer survivor 12 years now. I've been blessed by quality medical care, and it's my mission to bring attention to this disease that you can prevent death by screening and early checkups. And I'm grateful again to be on your show, Eric.
That's right. You're a second time. You're my first two-time appearance person here. So welcome back. And, of course, first of all, describe to us what the prostate is and a little bit of information about the prostate in the body of the man.
Yeah. So the prostate is a small portion of our body in the men's, of course. It's the size of a nut, so it's very tiny. It's located right below the bladder. So people with prostate cancer, usually one of the first signs is incontinence, urinary incontinence. And the purpose of the prostate is to liberate what we call the sperm. So that's mainly the main function of the prostate in the body of men.
Okay, and of course, yeah, I heard that it's about the size of a walnut.
Yes.
But the thing about it is it can do severe damage if it becomes cancerous. Tell us about that.
True, and one of the main issues with that is that when it expanded, that's when we know there's an issue. The prostate itself can get expanded. The size can change, even duplicate in size. It doesn't matter if it's because of prostate cancer. It can also be due to infection. So that's something that primarily when we are treating patients and we are seeing patients in the clinic, that's one of the first signs that we need to see, okay, the size. But that doesn't matter. Probably not cancer necessarily. Maybe it's an infection. That's where all their screening processes come into play to actually determine why it's not in the site that it should be.
Okay, and John, of course, you said a dozen years ago you were diagnosed with prostate cancer. How did that happen? How did you find out that you were afflicted with it?
Well, if I can go back, my father passed away with prostate cancer. And so doing a routine screening every year, getting my PSA exam from my medical provider, 2 years in a row, my PSA numbers went up. Mm-hmm. They didn't go up significantly, but they did go up. And in a consultation with my doctor, he reminded me that my father had prostate cancer. And on the rectal exam, he felt a nodule, but he couldn't really tell what it was or if it was anything significant. And he suggested that I should go see a urologist, and he would make the appointment. You know, and I'm so glad I did. You know, I could have said, no, I'm fine, I'm okay. You know, I'll wait till next year. But I went and went to the urologist, and they did the rectal exam and took samples of my prostate. And then within 2 weeks, they called me, and they wanted me to come into the office to, you know, for a consultation. And, you know, I'm a pastor and a social worker, so I convinced them to share with me, you know, the information via phone. And they told me it was positive for prostate. And it kind of shook me for a second. But then I had the assurance. They said it was just starting. They gave me what's called the Gleason score. And the Gleason score was low. And then he wanted for me to come in to have a consult. And so told my wife and family. And then we went in for the consult. And mine was just starting, just beginning. And they wanted to do what was called watchful waiting. And I said, well, what's that? And they said, well, we want to watch and see what it's doing. And I said, well, it's trying to kill me. And they said, no, you don't have the aggressive type of prostate cancer, but we would like to watch it. And I said, well, other than watching it, what are some other options? And they said, well, you're too young for chemo, radiation. I said, well, then what's some other options? And he said, surgery. And I said, well, let's do it. And he said, at your age? And I said, listen, I have a family. I have three children. I said, and I want this disease out of my body.
So you had the surgery as opposed to the radiation?
Yes, uh-huh.
Okay,
yes.
And how did that go? What was that like, and what kind of an effect did it have on you, just from the mental standpoint?
Oh, listen, I'm so grateful for modern technology. I remember when my dad had his surgery, man, they cut him from the rib sternum down and opened him up. Today, what's called the robotic surgery or the venturi robotic machine or the robotic surgery, man, it's just four little dime-sized incisions they make, in your midsection, and they go in with these bionic arms, I guess, and the doctors are, and so that surgery is highly effective, less invasive, fast recovery time, and so I had surgery on a Thursday morning, I think around 9 or 10, and I was back home on Friday morning by 11 o'clock.
Wow.
And so about a 3 or 4 week recovery time, and so different technology today, man, so different. And I'd say to men who are listening and to their spouses, the robotic surgery, is nerve sparing, that the things that, men dread of having happened to them, yes, you now are impotent that you cannot, produce children, but the nerve-sparing aspect of it in terms of reducing incontinence and the recovery, man, it was just, in my case, it was just fantastic for me.
And, of course, one of the things that we have to do when we go, I go to the VA myself here in Southern California, but they do what they call the prostate-specific antigen test, which is the PSA, where the proteins, they check for that to see what is that is produced by cells in the prostate gland and released into the bloodstream. That's the way a lot of people are notified because of their PSA levels.
Yes.
Is that what happened with you as well?
Yes, it was. The doctor does the annual rectal exam, but also the PSA test. And that was the test that notified us that my score had gone up 2 years in a row and was probably indicative of something else going on. And so I'm glad I listened to the data.
Was there any other, say, for instance, symptoms such as inflammation or anything like that?
No.
So it was just a routine exam?
Just a routine exam. It was discovered.
Dr. Gracia, one of the things, especially in the black community, men have a tendency, probably in most of them, but especially in ours, it talks about the fact that nearly 70% of a lot of the cases, unfortunately, that could be detected at an earlier stage, but because people have a tendency to delay going, and of course, just like with any other kind of cancer,
right,
early detection is the key. Why is it so difficult for people to go? Is it because they're afraid of hearing the C word? And but even when you hear the C word, it doesn't necessarily mean that it is something that is a death sentence. People beat cancer all the time.
That's true. And there are facts and there's data that back up why, especially for prostate cancer, it's so hard for men to go to the doctor. In general, men's the data back up the idea that men in general don't go to a doctor as often, mm-hmm, as females.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why when we go to communities, we talk to women, and mm-hmm, women usually bring them, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because there's there are different cultural beliefs. There are misconceptions too. There are religious beliefs too, where we are in a culture where screening is not a word, but then it's also the idea of what the doctor is going to do to me, right? Mm-hmm. So there are different aspects, especially, and I feel the misconceptions of the process is what makes people more afraid, especially men.
And from what I understand, when it comes to race, black men of the United States and other men of African mm-hmm ancestry are diagnosed with prostate cancer more than any other race of men. And unfortunately, black men, again, die at a higher rate than other men. Why is that? Is it because of the fact that we're getting diagnosed later?
That's one possible explanation. Obviously, genetic plays a big role. And with that, we have to go back to the transatlantic slave trade,
mm-hmm,
in which we know the stressed men were put into those slaveries, times.
So some of this can date all the way back to that.
Of course. And that's what we call epigenetics, that works that, study that. And it's known that cortisol levels in African-American men, or men that come from African ancestry mainly, their cortisol level baseline is higher. And that's one indicator.
The cortisone level, you said?
The cortisol,
okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Level. So what that does is makes a stress be one of the main factors, right, for this. Another option, too, it will be the late detection. Like, if men will get screened earlier, especially African-Americans, we have the history, like Pastor right here, or have the predisposition, just the race, just by the race.
John, what have you learned as a result of this, that as far as talking to other men, especially black men, what have you learned and what have you told them as far as prevention is concerned? And really, I guess the prevention for the most part is the fact that you could still live beyond the fact that you've been diagnosed.
Mm-hmm. Yes. You know, Eric, having the conversation, you know, a lot of guys I talk to, when they get this diagnosis, it's fear. Fear sets in. Panic sets in. They become immobilized in terms of making a decision. And I believe having a clear support network with your family, with your church, makes a big difference. And being able to have the conversation that just because you've been diagnosed with cancer or prostate cancer, it's not a death sentence, that you have options.
Mm-hmm.
And particularly if it's early. And then even if it isn't, there are still other things that you can do to maintain a great quality of life and cope with this disease. You know, and I know for a lot of guys I talk to, you know, this notion of being impotent, you know, or the digital rectal exam that you have
to. I think that rectal exam scares a lot of guys. So.
Yes.
Yes. And so being able to face that and go through it and get assessed, get the diagnosis, get screened for it, makes a difference. You know, when I was told of my score, my PSA score, I could have said, well, you know, it's low, it's not that high, you know, and, but the doctor said, didn't your father pass away with prostate cancer? And then knowing what I knew about his journey and at his end of life experience, how painful that was for him and what I saw him go through, it's like, I don't want to experience that. So let me go handle this now. The journey, you know, for me, you know, others have a different journey or whatever, but I've had great medical care. My doctors have been upfront. I'm the kind of guy who researches, asks questions, because
mm-hmm.
I want to know.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, yeah, I want to know what's going on. What are you going to do to me? Even when we agreed upon the surgery, I actually went online and watched the robotic surgery being done. Because I wanted to know when I'm out, knocked out, what's happening
right.
to me.
Okay.
You know, because information, I think, makes the difference. And knowing your options and then having support to make that decision to do whatever it is you're going to do, other than ignoring it, hoping it will go away. And, you know, and my family was very supportive. In fact, too supportive.
know,
man, listen, you know, I've never been sick before. And so first time, you know, as an adult being sick and watching my wife and kids, how they, you know, supported, cared for me, man, fed me in bed and brought me, you know, so that kind of lavish love on you or whatever, you know. But now, you know, it's my goal now to be able to share with everybody, every man, every family, that go get screened, go get checked out. COVID is over now. Go back to your doctor, go get yourself checked out. So this thing doesn't surprise you with a stage 4 diagnosis, and now all the heroics have to be done when early intervention could have been given to you.
Absolutely. Once again, everybody, I'm Eric J. Chambers. This is The Cut Chronicles, where we chronicle urban life. Thank you so much for tuning into the program right here on KCAA Radio, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM. We are an NBC affiliate. My guests tonight are John T. McColl, the CEO of DeVille Family and Youth Services of Pasadena, and he also happens to be a prostate cancer survivor, and in addition to the pastor of Bethel Missionary Baptist Church there in Pasadena. And also joining us is Dr. Gracia Hernandez. Hernandez. She is from the City of Hope, and we're hoping to get a call from Dr. Kimlin Tam Ashing from the City of Hope also. We're still standing by with her to get a call from her. But according to the statistics, this comes from the American Society of Clinical Oncology. They see around 60% of the cases that are diagnosed in people are in people of age 65 or older. The average age at the time of the diagnosis is 66, but they say the disease is rare to get in people under 40, but it can happen.
It can happen, especially when you have the history like him, when you have different factors that, for example, I have a list right here, socioeconomic status is something that we study as a health disparity level, diet, lifestyle, biology, stress, psychosocial stress. Everything plays, you know, a role, especially in this disease where we know stress plays a big role in it. And we know now that a race, especially African Americans, we are getting diagnosed, and they are getting diagnosed earlier, earlier than 40 years old. Mm-hmm. Even that's what the data is telling us. That's what research is telling us. So that's why it's so important that men get screened, get the surveillance, be proactive, because with that we can also use that information to develop clinical trials, right? That can help this population in specific.
And I think it's important for the men to not be afraid, again, because the life that you save could very well be your own. And we hope that those who are listening today who have family members who haven't been screened, that they'll get the opportunity to. I'd go to my VA checkups on the regular basis. My PSAs were, zero point something.
Perfect.
So I'm in good shape as far as that from just, I guess, about 2 or 3 months ago.
Perfect.
So I try to stay on top of that. And the best way to do it is to be on top of it before it's said too late. Again, family, I'm Eric J. Chambers. This is The Cut Chronicle. It's time for us to take our first station break. When we come back, we're going to talk about some of the signs and symptoms of prostate cancer, that and more. But first, a station break. When it's time to celebrate a loved one's life, McKay's Mortuaries can help. In addition to affordable funeral services with value, quality, and compassion, we offer luxury coach services that can accommodate the family and the deceased at the same time. Call today for an appointment at 888-860-3125. That's 888-860-3125. Or visit mckaysmortuaries.com. When that time comes, remember our name, McKay's Mortuaries.
Self-monitor your blood pressure in 4 easy-to-remember steps. Self-monitoring is power. Visit managerbp.org. Brought to you by the Ad Council, the American Heart Association, and the American Medical Association, in partnership with the Office of Minority Health and Health Resources and Services Administration.
Have you considered interviewing a parent or grandparent to preserve their history but don't know where to start or what questions to ask? If so, help has finally come. Dr. Eric J. Chambers presents Mama, I Want to Know You and Daddy, I Want to Know You, two books that will prompt you with over 200 questions that will help you record those sacred stories for the ages. Questions like, who were your grandparents? What were their occupations? Where were they born? Describe your favorite childhood memories. What are your fondest memories at Easter, Christmas, Thanksgiving, and more? What was the proudest day of your life? How do you want to be remembered? What are your favorite scriptures, colors, and food? These books will help you write your family's history. Do it before dementia or time robs you of this opportunity. Order your copies today at whodatpublishinghouse.com. That's WHODAT publishinghouse.com. Did you know there's a new Civil Rights Museum in the Inland Empire? It's the Civil Rights Institute, located at 3933 Mission Inn Avenue in Riverside. Its current exhibition, Still I Rise, The Black IE Fight for Justice, examines the lived experiences of black residents of the IE from the Great Migration until now. We're open Thursdays and Fridays from noon till 5. For group tours, call 951-682-5307 or visit inlandcivilrights.org. Thank you. Once again, everybody, I'm Eric J. Chambers. This is The Cut Chronicles, where we chronicle urban life. You're listening to KCAA Radio, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM. We are an NBC affiliate here in Loma Linda. And tonight we're talking prostate cancer. And I understand joining us on the telephone right now is one of your colleagues, also from the City of Hope, Dr. Kimlyn Tam. Are you there?
Good evening.
Good evening, Dr. Kimlyn Tam Ashing, I should say. Welcome to the program. You've been listening in, I suppose. So what are your thoughts on what we've already discussed here so far?
Well, thank you so much, Eric, for doing this important show focused on prostate cancer, especially among Black men. So we're responding at City of Hope and through the Eye Care Consortium, responding to the needs, the unique needs of Black men. And so we know that it's important to respond to our community's needs, and we're informing all that we do with the information from survivors. We're including advocates, survivor leaders, so that it's a co-development of everything that we do to target, specifically target, all of the cultural and sociological and community aspects that's relevant to Black men.
And tell me, what is your role with this particular disease?
Yes. So I am a professor at City of Hope. It's a comprehensive cancer center in Southern California. We are one of the largest oncology cancer center focused on building community capacity to address cancer needs. We have over 40 clinics within Southern California. I am also Associate Cancer Center Director for Community Outreach and Engagement. And so Pastor McCall has been one of our key lead community advocates, helping us lead our efforts to reduce the burden and risk of prostate cancer among Black men.
And tell us, Dr. Ashing, how important is it, as you mentioned, Pastor McCall is one of the drum majors with this particular subject matter, of course, because he went through it as well. But also, how important is it for us to share this information throughout the community?
Well, the community needs to understand that, as Pastor McCall said, that prostate cancer and many cancers, when diagnosed at an early stage, it's highly treatable and highly curable and reduces the risk and burden of the illness on that person as well as the family and community. So it's important that we engage community leaders, survivors, advocates, so that we could be truly responsive to the community, so that what we create is not only acceptable, but is clearly very responsive to the clinical needs, including, you know, the prostate cancer treatment. What are their fears? What are their concerns? You mentioned the psychological issues, mm-hmm. as well as what are the other psychological needs, the fear that they may experience, in order to address the spiritual needs. So what will help them in terms of working with that survivor to adhere to the treatment, to adhere to the screening, so they're not afraid of, say, the digital rectal exam, or afraid of the treatments that are very promoting of not only life, but quality of life. As Pastor McCall said, there's nerve-sparing treatments now with the robotic surgery. And so it's important to have the voice of the survivor.
Would you explain what that is, the nerve-sparing you just mentioned?
So it's minimally invasive surgery, so that it only targets the actual prostate cancer, so there's very little damage to the nerve and the muscle around the prostate.
Okay.
So the surgery is now much more precise, and there's less damage that could, you know, influence things like virility and other kinds of performance issues that very much men are concerned about. So the surgery, as Pastor McCall indicated, it's very minimally invasive. It involves just really targeting the prostate cancer itself.
Okay. And Dr. Gracia Hernandez, who's here with us also from the City of Hope, let's talk about some of the signs and symptoms. Give us two or three of them.
Yeah, so one of the most common symptoms, as I mentioned before, is the frequent urination. Mm-hmm. A dysfunctional, like, erection as well is another one of the main most common ones. Other one that is very common is blood in the urine as mm-hmm. well. That's other of the common symptoms, usually when the cancer is more advanced. Mm-hmm. Earlier is very hard, so you will see symptoms that are normal, mm-hmm. and I quote-unquote normal, when the man is older, but when you see this same trend in younger men, that's when it becomes a problem.
Mm-hmm. And understand mm-hmm. that there could be also pain or burning in the urination as well.
Yes.
Blood in the urine, as you mentioned there. And what are some of the, say for instance, what are some of the treatment options? I know we talked about the surgery. What are mm-hmm. some additional treatment options?
So treatment options, basically, if we paint a panorama of how that looks, it will depend on the stage of the cancer. If it's very early, they will do what they suggest a pastor, which is will be active surveillance. When it's very early, when it advances, then the patient is given the options of castration. It can be physical. It can be chemical castration with hormones. When the cancer is spread out of the capsule, of the walnut that we were talking about, when it's spread out, then the patients are given the options of chemotherapy. So usually one of the most common one is docetaxel, which is the one that patients are given, and it's a type of chemotherapy.
And I heard there's chemotherapy as well as radiation. Tell us the difference between chemo and radiation.
So yeah, so radiation goes, and basically there are these different isotopes that goes directly into the tumor. This is very important to notice, both of these type of treatments are very invasive for the body, especially also chemotherapy that goes into your blood. So that not only tackles what it's good cells, also bad cells. That's what in general, when a person is exposed to chemotherapy, the patient lose hair, the white blood cell count decreases, also the red blood cells decreases. So there are different damages, right, with the same treatment that the patient is given. So that's why it should be a process of talking to the patient to see what the patient is willing also to receive, but also keeping in mind what's the stage of the actual cancer.
And, of course, Pastor McCall, there are various different side effects that different people, I guess everybody has different reactions. What kind of side effects did you have, if you had any?
I didn't have any side effects per se to the surgery, except for, you know, given where the prostate is located, sitting on a cushion that mm-hmm. I remember being discharged from the hospital and they, you know, take you out in the wheelchair. And so every bump they hit, I could feel it. And so, you know, we had a pillow in the car driving home, but every bump in the road, you feel it, you know, because of where the prostate is located that. And even, you know, during the healing process, I wouldn't sit on a hard object without having a cushion to sit on because of the prostate surgery. You do these Kegel exercises to strengthen the urinary muscles, you know, get the muscles back in shape and stronger. And so if I sat on something hard and I got up, I would squirt some urine, mm-hmm. Which was embarrassing. And so, you know, the things that men have to go through, you know, and I think maybe for maybe a month, I think I had to wear Depends mm-hmm. Because of the urinary issue. Mm-hmm. But once I got to working on those muscles and getting those muscles back in shape, mm-hmm. Those things that men consider embarrassing, but being alive is much better.
That's right. The alternative when you look at that.
Yeah, the alternative is, you know, to be dead. And for me, that wasn't my option, to live and do whatever I had to do to stay alive.
So I guess really guys have to get over the fact, that you may have a small percentage of embarrassing situations there, but at the same time, you're still here. to be able to enjoy your grandchildren or your children or your wife or what have you.
Yes.
Dr. Gracia, there's also a lot of men, I'm sure, who are afraid that it will impair their sex life. Mm-hmm. What kind of effect does it have on that? Can a man still get an erection after having prostate cancer?
It does, especially, again, when it's caught early, there are options. One of the options is also the radiation. For example, one of the main results of the radiation, what we aim with the radiation is to decrease the size of the tumor, so it will be easier to pick it up. When it's spreading, then, again, we are damaging. If the tumor increases in size, what that's doing is damaging more tissue. So as more tissue we damage, erection is tied to nervous system. So if there's issues with the nervous system, with the muscles in that area, of course, prevention, I will say, is the key.
And, of course, some of the late side effects from, according to this particular website from the American Society of Clinical Oncology, are anemia, bowel problems, urinary problems, depression, anxiety, hot flashes, bone problems. Dr. Ashing, say, for instance, a person who has been diagnosed with this, of course, one of the first things I would think that would affect them is the depression. How do you deal with that? What would you say to someone who was diagnosed today, and, of course, you are anxious and depressed at the same time because you just don't know what the outcome is going to be? And when you hear the word cancer, you know, that is enough to scare the daylights out of somebody.
Yes. And I'm so glad you asked that, because that's one of the gaps that we are aiming to address with the iCare Consortium. That's a consortium of City of Hope, Mayo Clinic, 100 Black Men, and other organizations. Because even though prostate cancer is the most common cancer among Black men with the greatest disparities, we have very little studies focusing on us, focusing on Black men. And so there's very little research, evidence-based research, to go on to address the unique needs of Black men. And mm-hmm. so that's why the iCare Consortium exists. And so we are working with survivor advocates to inform the survivorship care plan, because we are building a survivorship care plan that's targeted to Black men with prostate cancer, because we understand that there are those unmet needs that we have little direction from in terms of the literature, in terms of the research. And so in working with our consortium partners, with the advocates that we've heard from so far, depression is not uncommon. And we have to deal with both the cultural issues of, you know, men should not feel sad, they should not be, you know, anxious, they need to face this with a stoic approach. And that absolutely is false. And so we want to normalize the fact that it is okay and very common for men to experience feeling sad, feeling a sense of loss, feeling anxious about the future. Those are all common effects of hearing that you have cancer. And so one of the projects of the iCare Consortium focuses at the point of diagnosis. When you hear those words, what are some of the resources that Black men need? Another component is looking at home care for those who are elderly or have other comorbidities. What are some of the ways that we could care for men in terms of home care? Because some of the hormonal treatments are actually oral medication that could be taken and monitored at home. The third project is focusing on survivorship care plan, which I am leading in that endeavor, along with Pastor McCall, who is my co-PI. And so we are working very closely to address those needs. One, to be open to seeking treatment if you're feeling down, open to be, you know, getting support, engaging with the family, being open to talk with the family and share your needs and burdens, because a lot of times people feel that they don't want to burden their family. And it's a way of engaging the family to also provide that support that Pastor McCall talked about that's so therapeutic in terms of the healing, in terms of improving the emotional well-being. And, you know, working with the spiritual beliefs and finding support in your spiritual community are ways to cope with depression. And for some, they may need professional support, and that's okay as well. So seeking support from organizations such as the Cancer Support Community or the Black Psychologists Association, those are opportunities to find support and healing for things like depression and anxiety.
So in essence, for those, say for instance, someone has just been diagnosed with it, you don't have to bear the cross alone. You can share that information with your family and friends, because unfortunately, I believe that some people try to bear it alone, and the next thing you know, they have done more damage to themselves by trying to keep it private. And, you know, next thing you know, you're in what, stage four, and being discovered that you died or close to death by the time others find out. What kind of support, Dr. Gracia, can family members, what kind of support should family members give once they know that a loved one has been diagnosed? And also, on the job, say for instance, you're working a job, you know, everybody is not going to be supportive. What would you say to people on the job as well as the family when a person is dealing with something that could eventually take their life?
Yeah, so in this case, and I will say in this sense, I had personally have a very close family member. My grandpa, he died from cancer 7 years ago. That's why I got into this career. So I feel support is essential. Mm-hmm. Understanding the process that a person that had the cancer, had the procedures that, like the pastor, understanding that they have some limitations too, you know, helping them, assisting them, you know, being present with mm-hmm. them, enjoying every process. You know, these are processes, we caught it early, we have options for them. So I feel support is essential, stabilizing that life, decreasing the stress, at least prostate cancer, we know cortisol levels, increasing cortisol levels, inflammation promotes the aggressiveness of this disease, and we have shown that in data. So I feel that support will decrease those cortisol levels, right? Mm-hmm. So we can feel that that can help the patient for sure recover faster.
And of course, Pastor McCall, early detection is the key, right?
Yes. We talk about depression. Initially, I didn't tell my wife.
How long had you known before you notified her?
Well, I didn't know, and that's why I didn't want to tell her that when my PSA went up and they scheduled me to go in for the exam, I didn't tell her because I wanted to wait whether it was good or bad. She was very upset with me for not telling her, but I didn't want to stress them out and alarm them in case it was nothing. And now, you know, I have three daughters, you know, all women in the household, and now they'll all be upset on edge. And, you know, and ironically, how she found out, and I don't mind sharing it, was that when I went in to get the, I saw the urologist, took the samples, I really felt violated, you know, regarding that process and hearing clicks in your, you know, in your ear and whatever happened. So I went home and took a shower. Mm-hmm. And so I'm coming out of the shower at midday, and my wife happens to come home to get something. And the question was, why are you showering in the middle of the day? And so now I have to share with her, and that's when all whatever happened and the upsetness for not telling you. And I said, well, there's nothing to tell. I don't know. You know.
That, so you were waiting for more of a definitive answer.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
And so that process of waiting and the anxiety of having to wait. I think it was 2 weeks before I got the information back. And man, that was the longest 2 weeks. Wow. And finally, when I got the news, I wanted to know it immediately. And they told me, and I said, I took a deep breath. And I said, well, let me get up and go home and now tell my wife, and then now we'll deal with it.
Okay. Well, what we're going to do right now is we're going to take one more station break, and we're going to come back and wrap things up. But in the meantime, if there's anyone that has a question for our guests here today, Dr. Gracia Hernandez, Pastor John T. McCall, and also with Dr. Ashing, who's also on the phone, now is the time to call. Our phone number here is 909-792-5222. That's 909-792-5222. Or if you are a prostate cancer survivor and you have a phenomenal story of how you were healed and how you got through it, We're standing by to hear from you, too. But until then, I'm Eric Jay, and this is The Cut Chronicles on KCAA Radio, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM. Back in a moment. Need to celebrate a loved one's life? McKay's Mortuaries can help. We offer affordable funeral services with value, quality, and compassion. And if you're looking for pre-planning needs, our agents are available to assist you in your home. We offer bilingual and multicultural services from our five locations. Call for an appointment today at 888-860-3125 or visit McKay'sMortuaries.com. When that time comes, remember our name, McKay's Mortuaries.
The possibility of lung cancer can be pretty scary, especially if you're one of approximately 8 million current or former smokers at high risk. That's why SaveByTheScan.org wants you to know that now there's a breakthrough low-dose CT scan that can detect lung cancer early, and it only takes 60 seconds. You stop smoking, now start screening. For an easy quiz to see if you're eligible, visit SaveByTheScan.org. It could save your life. SaveByTheScan.org is brought to you by the American Lung Association's Lung Force Initiative and the Ad Council.
Did you know there's a new Civil Rights Museum in the Inland Empire? It's the Civil Rights Institute, located at 3933 Mission Inn Avenue in Riverside. Its current exhibition, Still I Rise, The Black IE Fight for Justice, examines the lived experiences of black residents of the IE from the Great Migration until now. We're open Thursdays and Fridays from noon till 5. For group tours, call 951-682-5307 or visit inlandcivilrights.org.
Hi, I'm Beyonce.
I'm Kelly.
Hello, I'm Michelle.
And we're Destiny's Child.
Hi, I'm Chandra Wilson, and you're tuned in to The Cut Chronicles.
Once again, everybody, I'm Eric J. Chambers. This is The Cut Chronicles, where we chronicle urban life. And we are talking prostate cancer talk on this evening's program. And I understand joining us on the program right now is one of the project coordinators from the City of Hope. His name is James Morrison. James, are you there? Okay.
Hello?
Okay, there you are. How are you, James?
I'm doing well. How are you doing, Dr. Sanders?
I'm doing great. Tell us about what you do with prostate cancer in the City of Hope.
So at City of Hope, and I work under Dr. Kim Lanashun, so together we are, and Pastor McCall, we're working together to, you know, slow down the rate of, you know, the prevalence of prostate cancer in black men. So what I am doing is I do community outreach events, educational events. You know, sometimes I informally talk to guys like, hey, have you gotten your screening? Have you done this? Have you done this? So that's primarily my function. And I also am the project coordinator for iCare as well.
Okay, so what you've been listening in the entire program, what do you think and what do you want to add?
So I would like to add on that for a lot of guys, this is a very hard subject for them to approach, because when I'm out there giving a presentation about prostate cancer, just the very word back them up, they already kind of pull away. So we're trying to adjust their mindset to trying to solve the problem instead of being afraid to go even seek an answer. So from what I've seen is that men are actually going to the doctor a little bit more now. So that's the good news. But it's still not enough. They need to go get their screening, and, you know, prevention tools, like Dr. Hernandez said, is the lifeblood that keeps you safe.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for adding that. On my drive in, I want to give a shout out to my cousin Jesse, who is listening in Louisiana. So we have listeners all over the country, and he is a prostate cancer survivor, and we had a great conversation coming in. He told me that he did the radiation treatment. And he also knows other people who have done the surgery. And it appears that his radiation has done a better job than the surgery. If you were, say, for instance, Dr. Gracia, if you were, say, for instance, recommending one of these procedures, treatments, which would you recommend?
The first one recommended is usually radiation, because again, that shrinks the tumor, and then we're able to take it out more precisely. The surgery is good too, but there are always remnant cells that stay there. So with radiation and the actual surgery, we can tackle more cells. So as more cells we get out of the body that are bad, like the tumor cells, the better. So I feel both work side by side, very closely.
And what does the radiation consist of? What does that treatment consist of?
So it's basically is designed to go specifically to the actual tumor. And the idea is to kill specifically those cells. There are different type of radiations that are approved by the FDA. So the most commonly used tackles different proteins in the membrane of these cells. So it basically we are cooking these cells.
Oh, okay.
Basically. So basically that what does is decrease the nourishment of these cells and basically kill them.
And of course, earlier in the program, Pastor McCall talked about the Gleason score. Mm-hmm. Do you get that initially when you're diagnosed, or is that something that comes along afterwards?
That comes afterwards, for sure. So once you get the PSA results and the doctor determines that the levels of the PSA are in a range where it can be cancerous, then the Gleason score is the other option. So we do the PSA, the digital rectal exam, and then through a biopsy, if there all these indicators are positive, then with different samples from different areas of the same prostate, we can determine by using numerical values if it's high or low. And usually this is determined by a pathologist. Usually higher levels, close to 7, those are the more aggressive ones.
Okay. And Pastor McCall, tell me, what is your quality of life like as a result of you undergoing your procedure with prostate cancer?
I'm back to full health, no side effects or any of that. The surgery for me was the right thing to take, I believe, and not having to worry about prostate cancer or cancer inside of me. I wanted it removed. I wanted it out. Mm-hmm. And so I was too young for radiation or for chemo or any of that. And so the option was to wait, and I didn't want to deal with it sometime down the road. I wanted to deal with it then.
Okay, wonderful. Dr. Ashing, are you still with us?
Yes,
okay.
I am. And I wanted to, conclude my statements with some numbers and also some health tips from the research that's done at City of Hope and from the literature that we would have in the survivorship care plan that's very much tailored to Black men. So 30,000 Black men in the U.S. will hear those words. I have prostate cancer. 30,000 Black men. As we've been saying, early detection screening saves lives. So getting your annual screen, we want to activate men, as James indicated, to get the screening. Because even though our men sometimes have insurance, they have coverage, the clinicians, the physicians are not recommending it. There are guidelines that have now, affected the prescription and the recommendation for prostate cancer screening. But Black men have a high rate of diagnosis. So we want to activate the community to say, get your screening, talk to your doctors. If you have a first degree relative, like Pastor McCall indicated, that increases your risk. Know your family history, talk to your family, talk to your parents, grandparents, uncles, as a Black man, because it may run in your family and therefore you need to get screened and maybe even at an earlier age, but definitely at 40.
Okay.
And some of the health tips we want to put in our survivorship care plan that could be, what the family and the survivor does is reducing, sugary intake, sugary beverages, sodas, maintaining a healthy weight, getting a little bit more exercise, physical activity, cutting up the rug, even at home.
Okay, but I tell you what.
Animal fat.
Okay, well, thank you for that information. We've got less than a minute to go before we're off the air here. But thank you so much, Dr. Ashen, for joining us on the program. Also, James Morrison, thank you. Pastor John McCall, and also Dr. Gracia Hernandez. Just final 20 seconds. What do you got to say?
Yes, prevention is key, support is key, caring is key, and having a healthy lifestyle in general.
And you have something on Wednesday.
Yes, well, give the male figure in your life a healthy screening for Father's Day. That's the best gift. Go get your checkup.
And, of course, on Bethel's website, Bethel Pasadena, on Wednesday from 3 to 4 p.m., we're going to continue this conversation with Pastor McCall and some of his other constituents who have dealt with this as well. Thank you, family, for tuning into the program. Be sure to tune into the Jasper with Eric J. on this same station, Saturdays beginning at 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Until next time, for Dr. Gracia Hernandez, Pastor McCall, Dr. Ashing, and James Morrison, I'm Eric J., saying cherish the day.
Miss your favorite show? Download the podcast at kcaaradio.com.